participants.
And I think, I don't know how you are feeling, I think some of us are feeling a little chilled out here. So the AC can be toned down a little bit, except some of the images. As per the plan, I thought I'd like to, because there are two good presentations, from different sites. And I think, would you allow me to, around 10 minutes to actually give you the macro picture? Because I was thinking of both the presentations. Let me start with India and the world, where we stand today and what is the challenge. Because both of them talked about, Risto talked about how solar energy is a must and what is the way to go for that. And some details about different kinds of panels and different efficiencies. And Professor Sudhakar went into the how the biological route to energy capture, not only energy, not only the explicit energy, but the embedded energy that is there in almost, or not almost, everything. Because even this, all these have got an embedded energy, that you know very well. Let me just quickly put, because what, when we talk about solar energy as such through the PV route, it's the electricity. And in terms of India, electricity is just 16% of the total energy basket, and that to the commercial energy basket. So that means when we talk about electricity in the context of India, we are not talking about 84% of the primary energy consumption in India. That's just the commercial energy. And if you consider that even today, after 70 years of energy development, after 15 years of fairly high renewable energy development, biomass still supply in India more than the entire electricity sector. Biomass supplies 18% of our primary energy basket. Electricity, as electricity, we consume 16% of our total consumption. So these are figures that needs to be kept in mind, because often the urban mind don't consider energy in its entirety. It talks about energy and then goes into electricity. That's one of the major drawbacks that of thinking. And what is the challenge globally? Because all of us are talking about the urgency of shifting from one energy system globally. Today, even today, after more than 20 years of fairly well-developed renewable energy progress, the global energy supply is roughly 78% from fossil fuels. In India, it is around 86% of the total energy basket. I am not talking about electricity only. So in India, it's well above 80. Globally, it is a little below 80%. So, and even if you consider, and when we talk about an energy transition, let's also remember, because when you talk about, we have to transition from this fossil fuel based system, and the reasons are very clear, not only the carbon aspect, there are many other aspects, and we work deeply on that. In fact, water is a one critical aspect. All kinds of, when you go for electricity through the thermal route, the water is a major consumption. Any coal power plant consumes around, in India, 4,500 liters per megawatt hour. So that those kind of considerations are very clear. So it's not only the carbon, there are many other aspects. But if you just think about the electricity, which is globally, it is roughly around 30% in India, and countries like us, it's around 15, 16, 17%. In Bangladesh, it's even less. There are roughly around 6.3 million megawatts of installed capacity globally. And roughly 75% is still fossil fuel. So when you have to transition to a non-fossil fuel, even electricity system, what we are talking about is what we have achieved in the last 15 years. We have to achieve in the next 20 to 30 years, we have to achieve something like 6 times as much, minimum. Because as many of us know, there are 2 global compacts where there is a larger political consensus globally that by 2050, roughly 80% of the global energy system, and here I'm not talking about electricity only, the global energy system has to shift out of fossil fuels. And you know what those 2 global compacts are. One is the Paris Climate Agreement, the other is the SDGs. And both of them were agreed in 2015. The SDGs in 25th September, the Paris Climate Agreement on 12th November. So these are what we call a global consensus. The governments have agreed, though the work is not visible as it should have been. And India is actually, its drum beatings is much more. If you look at what is actually happening on the ground, it's not even 1/4 of what needed to be done at the urgent level. not even 1/4, and these are calculated statements. I'm not giving loose statements. I can give you afterwards what is actually there. So these are larger challenges. But beyond that, I think some of the very important factors that are not taken into consideration when we talk about coal and nuclear to photovoltaics and wind and geothermal and ocean thermal and biomass-based energy system. Number one, there are, even when you talk about, and this consideration is now coming into the transition discussion, the global trade unions and the national level trade unions are bringing this. Even in India, there are 2.8 million people involved in the coal industry. So if, supposing, and that's a desirable thing that has to happen, the system, energy system has to transition away from coal, coal and oil. Gas probably for some time, but gas is a very, very dicey situation, because if you have recently read about the methane bomb, then the fugitive gas emission is probably playing a much larger role than the coal expansion in the global context. But even if you think of just coal, where 67% of Indian electricity, 54% of India's total energy basket comes from coal, burning coal. There are more than 2.8 million people involved in coal industry. So the unions are saying, okay, it's good for saving the earth, we have to shift. But what about us? So that discourse, not only in India, discourse came later. Global trade unions, in fact, I was having, during the Bonn climate summit, I was having several meetings with different groups. Most trade unions are bringing this up, but nowhere the other discourses which are essential part are brought into it. Number one, coal, oil, or the fossil fuel industry has not only created jobs, and these workers have got a job, they have benefited, and they have come to a standard. But as per rough estimates, even in India, roughly 5 to 6 million people have been displaced by coal, both mines and power plants. So if you are talking about rehabilitating the workers of the fossil fuel industry, do this transition consider the people who have been victimized, who have been dispossessed by this industry? Without that, is there justice? Is there any possibility of reaching a consensus? That's not there. So we are not, in the transition debate, we have not started talking about what happens to the people who have been displaced, dispossessed, physically and economically by the fossil fuel industry. Number three, solar photovoltaic is a very desirable solution, but there are two factors which are to some extent, to a minor extent, being started to be tackled, but we have still not figured out the entire solution. Number one, you asked a question, it's not only the chemical pollution, it's not only the extraction, because solar photovoltaic construction also is a very energy intensive process. There's a huge amount of embedded energy in building the solar panels. And don't forget, if we take 40 more years or 35 more years to transition to a largely solar photovoltaic system, and by all calculations, on the earth, solar is the largest available renewable, no doubt about that. But during this period, we are not going to reduce our energy consumption drastically. So we will load the system, load the present fossil fuel energy system. We'll consume that. Plus, we'll have to in a very fast manner, we'll have to load the system for producing an extremely large solar energy system. So this calculation has never been attempted properly. These are now being attempted in a few universities. But still, and if the manufacturing energy intensity of the solar panels come down, it has started coming down, particularly with thin film and all, it might come down even further. But as of now, it do not seem that we can still achieve the climate targets. If we simultaneously, we have to go, and if we have to go, then the emissions will have to rise than just the consumption. So that's another. But more important than that, as I said, something like 6.3, 63 lakh megawatt of existing electricity, 75% roughly is fossil fuel. So if you have to transition out of that, then you also, solar energy, you know, is a very land intensive, it's a very diluted form of energy. People say it's 2.5 acres for 1 megawatt, it never happens like that. In a practical power plant, in anywhere you go in India, it's 3.5 to 4 acres at least. So if you have to put, say, 5 million, 50 lakh megawatt of new solar plant, a part of that will come on rooftop, but major part will have to come on the land. And at 4 acres per megawatt, just calculate the land. In India today, we have 3,35,000 of installed capacity. And this question that in India we need more electricity, that's entirely wrong. The government has now even accepted. Government of India has accepted that we are electricity surplus. This is the third year of electricity surplus. We have 3,35,000 megawatt of installed capacity. This year, our projected peak demand is around 1,75,000 megawatt to 1,80,000 megawatt. So if you take out the roughly 52,000 megawatt of solar and wind and run the rest of the so-called baseload power stations at roughly 75%, we still can generate well over 2 lakh megawatt. And the projections are, will not reach that kind of consumption for the next 5 years. And there are 92,000 megawatt of new power plants in the pipeline, which are being built at various stages. So if you calculate all this for the next 10 years, and in 2016 December, the Central Electricity Authority came out with a report, Mr. Piyush Goyal was the minister then, they admitted this. They said till 2023-24, we don't need any more power plant, and probably, hence, but after that, all the power plants that will be coming as additional will be renewables. So in a sense, coal will have to be phased out, will be phased out, it's not overnight. But the questions that are being raised, one, as I said, there are 6 major questions which we have not tackled clearly. One is the workers in the so-called dirty industry. What happens to them? They benefited, but they are not the creators. Second, the land question, the huge amount of land that you will need. And we all know, with urbanization fast increasing, with industries encroaching on land hugely, if you go and calculate, supposing India needs, the Indian projection is 1 million megawatt by 2032 or 2035. Now the last year's draft national energy policy projects 1 million megawatt by 2040, 1 million plus megawatt by 2040. So if you can consider, and out of that 450,000 megawatt will be coming from solar photovoltaic. Multiply that by 4 acres. That's 1.6 million acres. That's roughly 1% of our total agricultural land, and this do not include all the urbanization, industrial corridors, highways, everything. So there are major questions around that. The next question is the best places in, and this happens in many countries. Where is the largest, you know probably, the state and the area where the largest number of solar power plants are coming is Rajasthan. And of course, people will say Thar desert, it's a 320 cloud-free days, it's very nice. But this is the same place where villages do exist in the desert, in the arid lands, and because of the extremely low rainfall, their livelihoods are based on pastoralism, largely. They have one crop, but pastoralism is very prevalent, that needs a lot of land. And if you go to either Jaisalmer, and the follow the area of Jaisalmer, I have gone there 3 times and we have done some studies. You will see people really bitterly complaining that their pasture lands, one well out of 5 village which used to supply the water for their animals, goats and sheep, have been taken over by the solar plants because the solar photovoltaics need very little water, but they still need water for once a week or once in 10 days washing of the panels. So where water is scarce, the sunlight is very strong. Unfortunately, the coincidence is there. So what do you, like Vijayji was saying, there are a lot of human questions in this. The other question that is rarely raised is, when we do a transition, are we going to stay at the same consumption levels? In Delhi is a very high consumption city. In fact, in all of India, Delhi, in terms of electricity and energy consumption, per person per year, Delhi is the highest. You know what is the power consumption of Delhi? Electricity consumption per person per year? Roughly around 2050 kilowatt hour per person per year. What is the availability in Bihar? 160. Now it has gone to 170. The way we used to point out, the US consumed 12,500 units per person per year and India consumes 1,100 units per person per year on the average. Not consumption, that's the available generation. Consumption is just about 1,000. The differences within India is actually starker. And we don't question that.
we don't see India as multiple countries or multiple societies, not countries, multiple societies.